This is Rauda, and the event here is Midgard's Blood 2022. I don't know why I'm having this Viking voice, but maybe because I have some real-life Norwegian Vikings here. So, let's tune in a little bit. Normal voice.
Yeah.
Excuse me, sir. What the hell are you doing here with your own shirt and everything? Could you please introduce yourself to the camera?
My name is Frode, and I'm the bass player and vocalist in Ein Harjo.
And what about you, sir?
I don't have my band shirt on.
You're probably wrong band,
right.
You should go away.
Okay, I can do that.
No, sir, problem. Please.
My name is Gerhard, I'm the drummer of the same band, basically.
Let's tackle the first little tiny elephant in the room. I know it is a very Viking concept, and you always played more or less, well, Viking metal music.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean to you in this unholy lost year 2022? What is Viking metal? How you would define it? Because people are like puzzled who are not from the Nordic countries.
Yeah. For me and for us, actually since the beginning, has been, you know, that the Viking concept, that's a lyrical concept. So we have a basis in heavy metal, and we have a strong, grim Norse kind of voice to it. And yeah, as a whole, we then call that for Viking
I
metal.
I mean, yeah. We started the band in the early 90s, in the heyday of Norwegian black metal as well. It's just that I think we just took sort of a
little bit of a different route.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. We had influences from a lot of Norwegian black metal, along with classic heavy metal,
classic
and all that
metal
shit. But also like Greek black metal, Erotic Christ, Varathon, Necromantia, and also bands like Samael and stuff like that. So there was like a mesh of influences. Also with orchestrated music, you know, film music, theme music, and shit like that. So there is a whole big mesh in that.
And also, this was a day and age when everything was, you know, blast beats and stuff.
Yeah.
Everything was just a. But we have always been like a mid-tempo, heavy metal-based band, really. So I think we kind of stood out since the beginning, just based on that.
I mean, we listened to a lot of other stuff before black metal, like Status Quo, for example, shit like that, Boogie Time, and Kiss, and all that stuff. So we have influences from that as well. So together, it's, you know.
It's a mesh of everything.
Yeah, it's a mesh of everything, and a little bit of folk music. You know, just like a spice, not all in.
But also what's kind of, you know, tie everything together, you know, why we call it, or we call it, why some people call it Viking metal is the lyrical concept, you know. So it is rooted in the ancient myths and in, you know, the Norse way of thinking and that kind of thing. So, of course, over the years, this has been kind of watered out a bit, you know. It's a bit more subtle now than it used to be, you know. And
you
I think the lyrics are kind of more, they're smarter now.
Yeah, I mean, the older, older you get, the less rebellious you are, you know what I mean?
So could we even say that some of the corners are more rounded now and less edgy and more focused and maybe more adult?
You think about the music or the lyrics or
both?
I think we just changed a little bit. I don't know, it's difficult to say. I think we changed both lyrically and musically. We had a break for years, I don't know.
Yeah, it has been
during that break, we had problems. Which way to go? Should we pick up the old style, you know, the old songs and all that stuff, or should we just screw that shit and start from scratch, completely new?
Yeah.
And that's what we did. So I don't know, I think we just changed. It's like a watershed, we call it.
Yeah.
In 2000.
But your music stands timeless. I was actually listening at Tohodl, your latest album, just to kind of give me a reminder, like how things are, because I remember you hearing for your new music for the first time, I think it was late 90s. Can't say really whatever, it's 97 or 99 or whatever, but something like that. Now that I was listening to your latest material, it doesn't really feel that different. I mean, it's kind of a timeless, yeah. Because sound has technically evolved, but your sound, like not talking about production values,
is kind of
like timeless, yeah. Like as if you never changed so much. So what keeps you doing this on Harrier path?
We did, our first album, Dragons of the North, was released in 96. So in that album had a 20-year anniversary thing, we did some festivals where we kind of played the whole album. And after that, we just decided to re-record the whole thing. But the thing is that when we revisited the old material, it was kind of surprising for us, you know, to see the qualities that lies within there, and also the similarities towards what we are doing today. So I think that after the first album, we did kind of a detour and did different things for a few albums. Then we kind of got back into the same track. So
that's what I feel as well.
Yeah, yeah.
We had a side turn. And
you're right. It's not that different from what it used to be. You know, it's it's just a kind of natural involvement from
like
that.
We have a way of creating music, and it's not a recipe per se. It's just that me and Fuda, we know what we want. You know,
you have that chemistry.
Yes,
like,
I know what he wants, and you know, we've been doing this for 30 years.
Yeah,
you know that shit. So, except for that startup again, we had some problems. You know, which way to go? But when it was settled, you know, it was settled.
We knew. I think that was more kind of an anticipation kind of thing. You know,
yeah.
After you. We did, the thing was that in 2004 maybe, we just decided that we wanted to put this band on ice, and we did an album with a different band, just a thrash metal kind of thing. And when we then returned to doing in-house stuff in 2008, I think we started rehearsing for the Wacken show and that stuff. That was kind of, I think me and you had a kind of different, you know, anticipation about what we are actually gonna do. Are we going to pick up that stuff exactly where we left it? Or are we going to, you know, address, like you said, the elephant in the room that, all right, we need to talk, we need to know which direction we are gonna go now. And we did that, we did it a bit too late, because we started recording stuff for the Norren album, and a couple of songs that we started recording there never went on the album, because we couldn't figure stuff out between us two.
It was a problem, because we had some, to be honest, pretty good ideas from back in the day, from Blut and stuff. But we were unable to translate that into, our present style.
But I think we will now, because we have revisited that material. And
I think I don't know who said it, but you can't stop an idea whose time has come, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Sometimes if you revisit an old idea, now is the time. It was not the time then, but maybe now it is, you know? So,
Do you ever feel like I'm too old for this shit?
No.
Or is it more like this keeps me actually younger, as if I'm a vampire sucking on the blood of metal? And what keeps you young and fresh?
Time keeps surprising me, you know? Because now it's like next year, we've done this shit for 30 years.
Yeah.
Are you gonna celebrate it?
30 fucking years.
Are you gonna celebrate it in a special way?
We should, because we have many anniversaries.
We should. And we are also planning different kind of things, but everything, there's so many loose ends, it's not even possible to talk about. But the thing about time, you know, it feels for me that we have done this for, you know, I don't know, 5, 6, 7, 8 something years. That's what it feels like. But it's fucking 30 years.
Yeah.
And where did that time go? You know?
It's like you're the same person, no matter how old you are.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I know. It's not I don't believe in people changing.
No,
it's
not. We're not changing.
We're not changing
like
at all.
Yeah. We got better versions of ourselves.
Sometimes,
I think so too.
Not always, but sometimes.
Most of the time, sorry. Oh, yeah. I want to be optimistic about it.
Yeah.
The idea behind my question is more like this. Do you ever feel like, okay, I've done this Viking metal for long enough, now I want to explore my, say, this is our examples, I want to go some progressive elements, or like, more like, now we're going to go for the old school death metal that, that I grew up on, or maybe some like, hey, now I want to do that kind of a Kiss type of a rock and roll. You ever feel like, now I want to touch some other ground, like you mentioned, that
thrash metal thing.
We have done it, you know.
We have done it, and I also think that our expression is wide enough to kind of, you know, just swoop all that stuff into a big bag, you know. If we want to do a death metal song, no problem, you know.
Yeah,
we can do that. If we want to do classic heavy metal, sure, we've done that too. Only don't see all, you know. For us, I think we can put everything into this bag. But like I said, over time, it has that Viking concept has been sort of thinned out. And I think that musically, I still think we can go, you know, in any direction and do anything we want. But I think we are kind of, you know, locking ourselves into a very tiny area with the lyrical concept.
Kind of like too small of a box.
Yes.
We told the stories.
Yeah, yeah. You know, so over time,
many times,
I think that that has, you know, the kind of, you know, been, you know, thinner and thinner, and now it's kind of, you know, it's a subtle thing. I still want to keep it there, but
it's like a Jack Daniels thing, drink where the ice has melted. You know what I mean?
Now, okay, this is going to take a really stupid curveball question. No. I want to say it's stupid so that people understand I'm actually asking stupid things. But theoretically speaking, could we imagine hearing as a kind of a Cannibal Corpse version of Viking stories, like this is when Thor decided to pick some whales on his back when he was fishing, but this is done in a brutal death metal way?
No.
I said, it's a stupid
question. Not in a lifetime.
Back in the 90s, yes. I could easily have written...
maybe not Cannibal Corpse, but...
No, but that's kind of immature, like, you know, approach to it. Yeah.
We could do... We already had that, like... When the World Lies Dim stuff.
That was never released.
Never released.
But it was kind of
maybe it should
shitty.
For the 30s.
It was like a thrash death type style. So, we've been into it. But there is,
and also when you look at all the riffs over the years that has been thrown out, there's a lot of death metal there.
Also, lots of riffs, like... I have a shit ton of stuff on my computer, like... Mm. Riffs and a lot of black metal stuff, you know, so it's like the ideas are coming.
Yeah,
it's just maybe it's not fitting in this stuff, but I'll just leave it there for now. Maybe
also,
someday it will fit.
And also we still have you know bags and bags of the riff tapes from the 90s.
Yeah.
We still have loads
but
of
riffs. Do you have the technology to just actually listen to them?
Yeah, I have a tape recorder.
Okay, cool.
And tape player, absolutely,
So talking about this, a lot of Norwegian bands, which is probably the older generation knows, I'm sure they know, but the younger generation might even understand how much Norwegian, be it black metal or pagan metal or Viking metal, whatever stuff, was actually grown on this soil known as death metal. Mm. I mean, not only talking about Darkthrone or Immortal Guides, but a lot of bands started doing death metal before moving on.
Yeah,
and now it seems death metal has pretty much like died out of Norway.
Yeah.
I mean, there are not too many bands doing that. Why do you think Norway as a whole moved into that, like, hey, let's change the direction, let's move into this other area and never to look back?
Darkthrone did that.
Fucking Darkthrone.
Yeah, but if you're talking about death metal, that's the stuff I like.
Yeah.
Darkthrone death metal, you know?
Soul's Our Journey, that is.
Yes, Soul's Our Journey. And I like some death metal, but not too much. I like Autopsy, Pestilence. I'm not very much into like DSI and stuff like that. But I think the Swedes took care of the death metal.
More keep the sunlight sound right there in Stockholm.
But the Swedes are doing death metal great. Still to this day, absolutely. But I mean, when A Blaze in the Northern Sky was released, everything changed, really everything.
It was a shock to some people.
Yeah.
I think it was a shock to everyone, you know, because they had before that, you know, with Sosa Journey, they had an amazing death metal album. And that was more or less the standard, you know, that we were looking towards, you know, regarding everything. And when they released a new album in 92, it was like, what
happened?
Fuck is this? You know, so yeah.
After Far Far North, we released Odin Owns You All, the same stuff, but it didn't have an impact. You
know? That's for sure, it didn't have the impact. But everyone was going, what the fuck is this?
But then again, now it's...
It's a classic
It's a classic for many, many people.
Yeah, it is.
You know, even though it's like a really side turn, so...
Yeah.
Carl, do you need to restart? It would be a good time because...
I'm 15 minutes in.
Just making sure, because sometimes when we're talking about 30 minutes,
I'll raise my hand, but there's 2 minutes left.
Do it at 5.
5 minutes?
Because sometimes these guys talk so long, I'm like...
We can't shut up.
No, I need to... That's just to restart.
Yeah, no worries.
Because this is an American insurance thing.
Yeah.
It stops after 30 minutes.
Yeah, we've been on this route.
Okay. Yeah, Americans.
Once again, talking about Norwegian things and how you do your music, how big importance in your Viking themes is to stand against the modern society known as Christianity? Or is it more like, Viking and pagan themes go well hand in hand? Or is it something like, let's fight them?
It was more important before. Well, it was more evident before. I mean, I think still, I mean...
We're too old now, we don't care.
We're too old, but it's still a pestilence, you know what I mean?
It is, but we can't fucking get rid of it. It's just how it is, you know?
It is what it is.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it is diminishing every day anyway. It's going to kill itself, so...
People don't care.
At least, because I don't care if people are Christian or whatever. My mom is a Christian, actually.
I think a lot of our moms are, at least secular level Christians. They might not even go to the church, but they kind of like...
No, she's fucking proper diehard
Christian.
My mom is
Christian, you know what
I mean? So, Mom, if you're watching this, consider it.
She's not watching this, I can assure you.
Yeah, Sigrun, I'm pretty fucking sure you're not watching this.
Okay.
The point is that as a whole, it is a pestilence.
Yeah.
Individuals being Christians, fine, whatever. It's like humans are nice individually. As a whole, they're also a virus. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, talking about virus, this is an excellent question to tackle the other elephant in the room. Past 2 years has been a horrible thing for a lot of bands.
We're talking about
no
virus.
No shows, no goes. And some bands are twiddling their thumbs.
Yeah.
Some are recording material because you can't tour. It's a good way to make music. What did you guys do? How did you decide to solve the puzzle in the room known as Lockwit?
Yeah.
Lockwit. What? Yeah. Didn't really think about that. Okay, let's go.
Like a good combination, you know. Yeah. Lockwit.
COVID-18.
Yeah.
For us, it was actually a pretty good time frame to do stuff because we have just started recording the new album.
Yep.
And I don't remember right now, but I think
it took some time before got our asses.
Yeah, but it was more or less done. I think we have, you know, we are starting doing drums and stuff, and then you know, everything closed down and shit. So I think we have actually done most of the drums.
We did a great deal,
Yeah, but because I could stay at home working on stuff that was already recorded, and I was on my own anyway. So I recorded on basic guitars.
When you read the news at the time, at the beginning of the stuff, it sounded like it was doomsday, you know. The terror virus, and you know, we're all gonna die.
Yeah.
I think so. Okay, let's just keep some distance for a while. And
but also the newspaper said that, all right, this was in March, right? All right, so by May, everything will be fine. Yeah. Okay, good. All right, so it's a couple of months and we're done with this.
It doesn't really matter. But little bit did we know.
Little did we know, yeah. So first, we got the album done, everything was done, and the first question for us was, are we going to release this?
No.
So we postponed it for about a half a year.
Yeah.
And it is something about, you know, when you have a finished album, you know, ready to release, it is hard to just not release
it. Exactly.
So,
Be there, done that.
Yeah, so for us it was like, okay, fuck it. We just gave it, you know, 6 months, you know, delay, and yeah, we released it. And by the time we released it, there was a kind of an opening in Norway where you could play for, you could gather like 200 people.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we decided to have a release party at a proper, you know, concert venue, concert house in Haugesund, and we booked that. But just a couple of days prior, the restrictions got, you know, more restricted, so it was only 100 people who got in.
Yeah.
So okay, surprise. What the fuck do we do? Should we call 100 guys and just tell them?
Like an elitist
party.
Come.
Yeah. So we decided to just do two gigs, you know, a Friday and a Saturday, and we split the crowd. And since this is also where I do my day job, I'm a stage manager at that venue. We just thought, okay, how about recording this? You know, everything is kind of set up, and we have days, you know, to do pre-production and everything. So this is kind of the perfect setup. The crowd isn't too much, you know, 100 people, that is more or less nothing. Okay.
Kind of a party.
Yeah.
It's like a 550.
But anyway, we just decided to, okay, we're going to record this. So we recorded both nights, and I didn't think much about it, but a few months after the show, I just listened back to it, and the first night was all right, but the second night was fucking great. And that's when we started thinking about, should we release this as a live album? So I just tried to mix one or two songs just to, you know, get a feel of it, you know. What does this sound like? Is it good enough? We've never done a live album before. So I think the material was great, really. Yeah. It sounded great.
Sounds great.
Yeah. So I was like, okay, fuck it. Let's work towards this. And since we had like shows for 2 days, we could kind of, you know, pick, you know. I fucked up bad there.
It's basically being up the pieces.
So I could, okay,
we fuck up.
I can take this from the other day. So in the end, we managed to actually put together all songs we did those nights, and the album is out now, you know, Norse and Dangerous, a live album. So,
and I think like it turned out cool. I like that it's, I don't know, some kind of document of the COVID.
Yeah.
I don't know if you demonetized or whatever, they're saying that word, but you can bleep me out.
Yeah.
But still, I like it that it was during that period and that it was our hometown, you know what I mean? So.
I've also
first
read
time we released an album, it's from our hometown.
Yeah.
Like, that's where the inspiration for us lies anyway. You know.
I've also read a few reviews, which is mainly great. But some guys are kind of pointing out that, but you can't really hear the audience. But why is the audience so loud? It's like, really? It's 100 fucking people there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's
They made a lot of sound. For
they did
people.
For cool 100 people, it's fucking amazing.
No, most of them on both gigs, you know, so pretty cool.
Now, other thing that is related to this, well, loosely, but nonetheless, is that a lot of people wonder how many bands are actually, you know, making the livelihood out of creating music, touring on all that stuff. Do you want to crunch some numbers? Like, you said you have a day job.
I do.
You both have a
we
day
all,
job.
All of the people have that. So
how much you can compensate by, say, touring and, you know, you don't have to give exact numbers, but just kind of a scale idea.
Yeah. It is kind of, you know, where do you want to live your life? Do you want to live your life at home, or do you want to live your life in a tour bus? If you want to live your life in a tour bus and tour, like, I don't know, 9, 10, whatever months a year, you can make a living, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But we do, what do? Like 20 fucking something gigs a year.
Yeah,
that's not too much.
It's not
that
much.
We have to
use my vacation for this.
Yeah.
It's, I guess it's kind of different from musician to musician, but it is also what you want to do. Do you want this? Do you want to, you know, make this a living? Do you want to, you know, change something into something else just to make more money? Or you
let's
just
sacrifice
something. Or you just want to keep this pure, keep this clean, do what you really want to do, you have a day job on the side, and keep this the way it should. So I don't know. It's
for it, some it people. It also depends on who you are. You know, it's like if we toured for 9 months a year, I would be dead right now.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. Seriously,
it's impossible. Yeah. It's impossible for us to do
that. And she's got kids, and other people have kids. It's not possible, basically.
Now to tackle this question: is Anherier more of a live band or a studio band?
I think we're both.
But if you had to choose, like, you can have 50-50, but more like 51-49.
Personally,
or?
Studio band.
Okay. What about you? How do you feel about it?
I feel like we are a great live band. But we don't, oh, that's a big one.
Let's not make us attack us.
Yeah. The point is that when we make songs, we don't really consider, well, how the fuck do we do this live?
That's true.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So
we
make the song, it doesn't matter how many, how much shit we cram in there.
Yeah. Yep.
As long as it sounds good.
It's all about the song.
Yeah, it's about the song. But we also, I don't know, of course, I think we're a good live band. I mean, we try to implement the important parts live anyway.
But I do agree. It is mostly the studio that is important.
Yeah, I mean, that's everlasting.
Yeah, it is.
You know, I mean, if you play
but
a gig.
But it is cool to be a good live band as well.
It is.
Definitely. Yeah. Now, this is a question for both of you guys. Let's start with you. Now, if you could give an advice to your former self, like this or do that in a band, what would you say to your former self? And this, of course, applies to younger audience. I hope there are younger audience. Like, okay, I am having my own band. Please help us. What do you would say?
I think keep continuity. You know what I mean? We have a lot of changes, both in lineup, in record labels, and all that stuff. It's been like a bumpy roller coaster kind of thing.
Like a roller coaster ride.
Yeah, yeah. So I think through your choices like 10 times before you decide on anything. You know what I mean?
That is a really, really good advice.
And also read the contracts.
Well, this is something for you tomorrow. Yeah. But now that you've stolen the best answer, that's the hard part.
That is
first,
definitely the best answer.
Now you have to kind of pick on that. So what do you would tell your former self?
Since Gerard stole the main stuff, I think that...
The main story.
The main story, yeah. Okay. You're going to do this live and from a stage, and you need to be prepared. You need to rehearse in the same kind of, you know, setup, environment setup that you do on stage, because for a brand new band that hasn't had a lot of, you know, live experience, that can be a rough transition. So just that, you know, that you are actually, you know, you are playing a gig towards, you know, when you with the back towards your drummer. If you are used to looking at everything he does,
you're gonna get fucked.
You're fucked, you know. Yeah. So rehearse in the same you know, setup that you are doing on stage, you know. So
and also, people should be ready.
Yeah. Before.
Like mentally. For this thing, I mean. The tour we had around Odin on Seoul, just don't drink it all away, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's gonna fuck up your mind. Just be ready and practice, that's all I'm gonna say.
All right, if you could get one line of wisdom for the audience, any kind of a, hey, this is my life coach tip, you start first.
Ooh, that's a heavy one. That's a heavy one, and I came quickly.
Because now you're all warmed up and all.
Yeah, yeah.
And then dried out, like.
Yeah, we're warmed up and dried out. Yeah. it is. You should. You know, that's a cheesy thing, but what we are doing, we are following a dream. We are. You know, me and you. We have been friends since we were, you know, kids, you know, five, 6 years old.
Thanks for showing these signs.
Yeah.
They're always that size.
Very important detail, yeah. No, we were next door neighbors, and long before we even, you know, got instruments and stuff, we decided we're gonna start a band, you know. We were Status Quo and Kiss fans, and we were, you know, drawing, you know, covers and shit, and
like stage setups and
all that,
like
kind of shit, you know. And now this is probably 40 years after that, after we did that. You know. And we are doing that stuff, you know, that we were dreaming about as kids. So don't stop dreaming. Do that stuff, you know.
Don't stop dreaming. That's a really nice cliche.
Yeah.
And cheesy.
And don't
right
stop believing.
Oh, yeah. No! Stop my journey line!
Journey!
Okay, this is a really, really good way to end. We're talking about journey here, which means we're buns of old nerdy geeks doing writing stuff and all. And you, right there, audience, check out these guys' music, of course. Check out them live once you have. I've been waiting to see them for more than 25 years. Now here we are in Midgard's plot, and you have some job to do. This is your, schoolwork thing project. You listen to these guys, listen to what they have to say, and enjoy their music. This is Midgard's plot, this is Rauta. Stay metal, stay true, don't be a jackass. All right, guys.
All right, thank you.